Today I'll show you how to vectorize images in Adobe Illustrator. And more than that, I'll also force myself to use different methods and techniques for different parts of the image, so I can showcase you all the different ways you can create vectors inside Illustrator. So this video is also a general tutorial on how to use the software. We're gonna use geometric shapes, the pen tool, the pathfinder, the shape builder, and all that good stuff. Vectorizing is very useful to convert images that are made out of pixels, like PNGs and JPEGs, into vector artwork, which you can basically scale to infinity without losing quality. And that's super useful, so let's get started. First thing we need to do is import the image to Illustrator, and that is as simple as dragging and dropping, but you can also use the File menu and choose the Place option. Then select your image and click anywhere on the artwork. If you want to follow along, there's a link to download this image on the description of the video, and Patreon supporters will also have access to an exclusive Illustrator file with detailed instructions for this lesson. You can support the channel for only $2 a month, and the link is also in the description. After the image is inside Illustrator, we're gonna align it to the center of the artboard using the control bar up here. Then we're gonna bring the opacity down to around 50%, just so it's easier for us to see the vectors that we'll create on top of the image. And I'm using the Properties panel to do it, but you can also use the Control Bar or the Transparency panel. And talking about panels, if you can't find a specific panel that I mentioned on this tutorial, they can all be opened through the Window menu. After making the image transparent, we need to lock it so we don't accidentally select it or move it around as we work on the vectors. And the way to do this is by going to the Layers panel, opening the layer by clicking on this little arrow, then looking for the image object, which will be listed as Linked File. Then we can just click on this empty box, which will toggle the lock on the object. The other way to do this is by selecting the object on the artboard and pressing Ctrl 2. Lastly, we'll change the selected color in the color panel, just so it's easier for us to see the vectors. We'll change it to something colorful and bright, like red, and we'll also remove the stroke for now. Okay, now we're ready to start vectorizing. We're gonna go letter by letter, starting with A. The first thing we need to do is try to break down this shape into its building blocks. Primarily, what we're looking for are geometric shapes. Which shapes can we use to recreate the image that we're seeing? It's almost like playing with Lego. Which blocks would I use to build this shape? By doing that, we're able to choose the best approach and the best technique to vectorize that specific part of the image. Like, will we use rectangles, or the pen tool, or perhaps the pathfinder? Things like that. And the cool thing is that we have multiple ways of building the same shape. For example, we can make this A using only strokes. We make a rectangle, remove the fill, and add a thick stroke. Delete the bottom path, round up the top corners, and add a horizontal line in the middle. Or we can make two rectangles for the stems, one for the crossbar, two circles for the arc, and then combine everything using the shape builder. And did you see how I think about geometric shapes not only for the shape itself, but also for things like holes or cutouts? For example, a third option would be to make one big rectangle with a rounded top and two other rectangles for the holes in the middle. Actually, that sounds kinda nice. Let's do this one. We're gonna start by drawing the holes, and the reason for that is because they are aligned to the center of the shape, so they will also serve as a guide for the main shape later. We'll press M to select the rectangle tool and click and drag to draw the bottom hole, trying to align it as best as we can. We don't need to worry about aligning it at the bottom though, because this shape will be deleted later on anyways. Then we'll duplicate this rectangle for the second hole by dragging it holding the Alt key. By the way, after drawing the first rectangle, I switched back to the selection tool, shortcut V. We'll also hold Shift while duplicating to lock the movement vertically, just to make sure they're both perfectly aligned to each other. After that, we can just scale this rectangle vertically until it matches the height of the hole. To make the rounded top, we'll use the Direct Selection tool, shortcut A. Select the two anchor points at the top and round them using the Live Corners widget. Now, for the actual letter itself, we'll draw one big rectangle, using the Smart Guides to make sure we're aligned with the holes. By the way, Smart Guides are these pink lines that help you align objects on the artboard, and they can be turned on or off through the View menu. Then, we'll repeat the process of rounding the top of the rectangle. Finally, I'll change the color of this object and send it backwards until we can see the other two rectangles. Remember, Illustrator has a stacking order for objects on the artboard, so they're always above or below each other. We can change this order and send objects forwards or backwards using the right-click menu and going to the Arrange option, or using the shortcuts that are listed on the menu. The step is optional, but I'm doing it just so you can better see the shapes we've created. Lastly, we'll wrap everything up using the Shape Builder tool. We'll select everything with the Selection tool, then press Shift-M to select the Shape Builder, hold the Alt key to switch the tool to the Delete function, and click once on the shapes we need to delete. The final touch is to round some corners of the letter. You can see that all the outer corners are slightly rounded, so we'll select every corner that needs to be round, which in this case are the four corners at the bottom, and we'll actually use the control bar to input how much we want to round them. This way we can round every corner on the whole image by the same amount, giving us consistency. We'll go with 2 pixels. And there we go, A is ready. I know this was sort of a big and slow-paced introduction, but I really wanted you to see everything that I'm thinking about when I'm doing this kind of work, to showcase you that there are multiple ways to tackle the same problem in Illustrator. And although this can be daunting for a beginner, there are just too many ways to do the same thing, this is what is going to allow you to be more efficient and work faster as you get to know Illustrator more and more. Now we'll pick up the pace for the next letters and be a little bit more straight to the point. So, let's go! For the letter N, I'm thinking again of geometric shapes, and I spot right away 4 rectangles. 2 for the stems, 1 for the diagonal stroke, and 1 for the underline. We'll select the rectangle tool by pressing M, and we'll start with the underline, so we can once again make use of the smart guides for the rest of the letter. And actually, the underline itself is drawn with the help of the smart guides, since we're aligning it to the baseline of the letter A. Once the underline is drawn, we'll draw another rectangle for the left stem, making sure it is aligned by using the smart guides. For the right stem, we'll just duplicate this rectangle by dragging it holding Alt and also holding Shift to lock the movement horizontally. Make sure the right stem also aligns with the underline. Finally, for the diagonal stroke, we'll make a third copy of the rectangle and place it right in the middle. In order to skew this rectangle, we're gonna press E to select the free transform tool, which will open this widget with a few options. We'll select the bottom one, which is called free distort, and also check the first option, called constrain. This will lock the movement of the distortion. You can see that if we don't select it, we can move the corners in any direction. But once we constrain them, they will only move horizontally and vertically, which will help us a lot. Then, we just have to move the corners sideways until we match the angles of the diagonal stroke. Now, the basic shapes are ready, and we just have to refine them. You can see that we ended up with some corners sticking out, so we'll use the Shape Builder once again. Select everything, Shift-M to select the tool, hold Alt to switch to the Delete function, and then we'll just click once on the shapes we want to delete. After that, we'll release the Alt key to go back to the Unite function of the tool and click and drag to join all these pieces together. Now, all that's left to do is round the corners. But before that, I want to get rid of these 2 anchor points on the diagonal lines, because they basically serve no purpose. So I'll press the minus key to select the Delete Anchor Point tool and click once on each anchor point to delete them. Now, we can pick the Direct Selection tool by pressing A, select all the corners we want to round, and input 2 pixels on the control bar. By the way, to select multiple anchor points, you can hold Shift to add or remove anchor points to the selection. For the letter D, we're gonna do the same thing we did with A, starting with drawing the hole with the Rectangle tool, then selecting the 2 anchor points on the right and rounding them with the Live Corners widget. Then we're gonna copy this rectangle with Ctrl-C and paste it on the back with Ctrl-B. The nice thing about rounding the corners with the Live Corners widget is that you can scale the object however you want and the corners will not get distorted. The Live Corners will stay active and you can change the radius later on. With that in mind, we're gonna scale this new rectangle we just pasted until it matches the silhouette of the letter D, and then select each corner at a time with the Direct Selection tool and adjust the radius of the roundness. Lastly, we'll select both shapes, and instead of using the Shape Builder, we're gonna use the Pathfinder panel, just to change things a bit. Open the Pathfinder and use the Exclude function. This function uses the object that's on top to carve a hole on the object that's on the bottom. This is why we pasted the second rectangle on the back of the first using Ctrl-B, which is the shortcut to paste in back. Keep in mind that you can open the Pathfinder panel through the Window menu if you don't already have it. Once again, we'll select the corners we need to round with the direct selection tool and use the control bar to round them with a radius of 2 pixels. Next, we have Y, which will be similar to the letter N. We'll start by making a rectangle for the stem and scaling it up vertically until the point where the arms of the Y start. Then, we'll duplicate it by dragging holding Alt and holding Shift to lock the movement vertically. We'll place the second rectangle aligned with the top of the letter and then scale it down until it touches the stem. Now, we'll use the Direct Selection tool to move the anchor points to the side until we can match the angles of the left arm. The bottom left anchor point is the only one which will not move. After that, we'll duplicate this arm, once again holding Alt and Shift, select the Reflect tool, shortcut O, and then click and drag, making a horizontal line to mirror this object. We should also hold Shift to lock the movement so we don't accidentally flip in the wrong way. Now we can place the right arm of the Y in its place, aligning the bottom right anchor point to the stem. We'll select everything and use the Shape Builder to merge everything into a single shape. Lastly, we'll select the anchor points that need to be round and input 2 pixels on the control bar. The next letters will be extremely easy, because they're all basically just rectangles, so there's nothing new. Let's just go bonkers on the rectangles until we draw everything we need. Make sure to make good use of the duplicate shortcut by dragging holding Alt and the smart guides to help you align everything. Once we've drawn all the rectangles, before we merge them all together, we can actually make a copy of the letter T, because it will repeat again on the next word. So just select the 2 rectangles on the T and duplicate them to the right, always holding Shift to lock the movement. We will have to adjust the size of the bar on the second T because it is a little bit shorter, but nothing too difficult. After everything is in place, we can just go wild with the Shape Builder and merge everything that needs to be merged. Then select the corners that need to be rounded and round them through the control bar. Now for the big elephant in the room. We need to draw the letter S, which not only is a difficult letter to draw by itself since it's so full of curves, but this one is also rotated. But fear not, because we'll do this in no time. Pay close attention though, because there are a few steps that we need to go over. First, let's unlock the image, duplicate it, and then lock the original again. On top of the duplicate, we'll make a rectangle roughly the size of the letter S, and dim the opacity down a little bit. We'll select the image again, press R for the rotate tool, and click and drag to rotate the image until the letter S is as straight as we can make it. For me, it was about 22.6 degrees of rotation. Then, we just have to align the rectangle to the letter, select both the rectangle and the image, and press Ctrl-7 to create a clipping mask, isolating the letter S from the rest of the image. Now, we can place it back on the artboard, lock it, and work on vectorizing it. Right away, I can see that this letter S is not just curves. It has some parts that are straight lines, so we'll start with those. We'll draw a rectangle right at the end of the letter S, and I'm figuring that the straight parts are aligned horizontally, so we'll duplicate this rectangle over here, holding Shift to lock the position, and yeah, it looks like I was right. For the curve at the top, we're gonna use 2 circles. We'll press L to select the ellipse tool, position the mouse cursor to align with the top of the rectangles, and draw a small circle holding Alt, which will place the center of the circle where the mouse cursor was. Then we'll stretch the circle to the sides until they touch the corners of the rectangles, and upwards until it aligns with the letter below. Note that I'm holding Alt again when I scale the circle vertically. This will keep the center of the circle in place. I can see that the circle is not matching the curve of the letter just right, so we'll adjust that by picking the Direct Selection tool, selecting the top anchor point of the circle, and dragging the handle sideways until the curve matches the letter. We're also holding Shift here to lock the handle on a horizontal position. After that, we'll simply copy the circle with Ctrl-C, paste it on the back with Ctrl-B, and repeat the same process, now aligning to the outer bounds of the letter. Before we combine these shapes with the Shape Builder, we're gonna delete the bottom anchor point of both circles, since we don't need the bottom half of them. Then, select everything, Shift-M for the Shape Builder, Alt, and click to delete the smaller circle. And then, release Alt and click and drag to merge everything together. The cool thing is that the bottom curve of the letter is exactly the same, so we can just copy this object, rotate it 180 degrees, and place it at the bottom. Now, for the spine of the letter S, we'll use the Pen tool. Make sure you don't have any object selected and press P to select the pen tool. We'll only need 4 points for the spine, one in each corner of the rectangles. Let's start with the top right one, aligning the mouse cursor to the anchor point of the rectangle and then clicking and dragging downwards, holding Shift to lock the handle in a vertical position. Then we'll go to the bottom right corner and repeat the same process. Click and drag downwards and then hold Shift to lock the handle vertically. Don't worry about matching the curve now. Let's finish the shape and then we'll come back and edit it. We'll just repeat the same process for the other two corners, but now dragging upwards. So click, drag, shift, and then click, drag, and shift. To close the path, we'll click back on the first anchor point that we've made. Now, we only need to adjust the handles to match the curves of the spine. But before that, I like to dim down the opacity of the object so we can see what's below. Now, we'll select the direct selection tool and edit all the handles, making sure to always hold Shift as we drag them up or down, to always keep them perfectly vertical. After the curves are adjusted, all that's left to do is bring the opacity back up, select everything, open the Pathfinder panel, and use the Unite function to merge everything together. Round the corners to 2 pixels like we did with all the other letters, and there we go! A perfect S, with beautifully aligned anchor points and perfectly straight handles. This is as good as a vector can get, not a single unneeded anchor point. Now, just move the letter back to its place and rotate it again until it matches the image below. Moving on, we have a series of really easy letters. The T is already in place, the H and I are basically simple rectangles, so no need to go over them in detail, and the N is literally the same as the other one, so you can just duplicate it. For the G, we'll try a rather unusual approach, which is not necessarily the best, but it's just to showcase how you can really use different techniques in Illustrator. And this one will also be a great exercise of working with handles and anchor points. We're gonna use the pen tool and draw a path that runs exactly in the middle of the letter. Don't forget to remove the fill color and add a stroke. And remember to make all handles perfectly vertical or horizontal by holding Shift. You can also place anchor points in a straight line by holding Shift, which is what you should do on the sides. Once we have made the entire path from one end to the other, we can adjust the thickness of the stroke through the stroke panel, and then fine-tune the anchor points and handles because we probably won't get everything right in the first try. Now, we can clearly see that this is not enough to recreate the shape. The thickness of the stroke varies a lot all throughout the letter. So what we're going to do is go to the Object menu and select the option Expand Appearance. This will turn this stroke into a filled object. And now we can swap to the Direct Selection tool and really fine-tune all the curves and lines on this bad boy. We're just gonna give it a good zoom and move the anchor points and handles, aligning everything the best we can. It can take you a few minutes, but don't worry, we're not in a rush or anything. Once every anchor point is in its rightful place, we can just apply the rounding to the ones that need it. And then, G is ready. For this last letter, the second S, the best way to approach it is definitely by drawing everything manually using the pen tool. We'll press P to select the pen tool and then just trace over the entire letter, making sure to place the anchor points at the apex of the curves and making the handles perfectly vertical and horizontal by holding Shift. Don't worry about making the curves perfect the first time, because we'll come back later and adjust everything. If you end up having a curve where the path needs to be straight, you can always press Shift-C to select the anchor point tool and click once on the handle to delete it, making the corner sharp. After everything is drawn, we can use the direct selection tool to fine-tune and adjust all the anchor points and handles. It's recommended that you also dim down the opacity to make it easier to get the curves right. When we finish drawing, we'll round the corners on both ends of the letter, and then we're done. We vectorize all the letters on the logo. Now, all that's left to do is draw the speech balloon. But at this point, I think you can do it on your own, so I'll leave this one as homework for you. If you enjoyed this video, check this other one here. A special thanks to all my Patreon supporters who help me make high-quality content like this one. More on how you can support the channel in the description down below. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and leave a comment if you have any doubts. Thank you so much for watching, and have a great day. Bye!